I'm Scott Van Pelt here at ESPN. This astounding and unprecedented story continues to evolve. At halftime with Adrian Wojnarowski, I suggested that we would speak to him soon. I had no idea that it would be this soon. He has just tweeted within the past 2 minutes that the NBA is suspending the season.
The NCAA making it official. The NCAA tournament has been canceled for 2020.
The impact of the coronavirus is now hitting Southwest Florida where it hurts, and that's Major League Baseball. They're now delaying the start of their opening day and calling off and canceling the remaining games for spring training.
The Centennial Conference has decided to suspend all intercollegiate competition.
Their major sports cancellation being announced today.
Yeah, not good. Minor League Baseball canceling their season today because of the coronavirus pandemic.
So we're in Florida. We find out when we get back, everyone's gonna have to leave campus. So, you know, that was like, you know, maybe on a Wednesday or Thursday. So we treated our last day in Florida. We scrambled to find a game because the team we were supposed to play had to get sent back to Pennsylvania. So we're scrambling to find a game. We find a team to play. And as a coaching staff, we were like, okay, we're gonna have to treat this like senior day because we don't know what's gonna happen. You know, we hope we're coming back in April, but you know, it's just all such new territory for us. So we were able to get our seniors in that game, you know, even some guys that were hurt, get them in and recognize them. But it wasn't the same. It wasn't like those guys went from being down in Florida, you know, and having a whole season ahead of them to being told within a matter of 24, 48 hours that their college careers could come to an end.
Dig, attaboy! Let's go!
Get moving.
Great job, Sawyer, great job!
I think as a coaching staff, we felt so great about where the team was at. We had such a combination of, you know, older guys that were, you know, peaking in their careers, and then a younger group of, you know, sophomores and juniors that were playing really well. I mean, Max Ruvo was, you know, having statistically one of the best offensive seasons I've ever seen. He was unbelievable, hitting triples, home runs, extremely high batting average, high slugging percentage. Like, it was unbelievable. Ryan Zweer, who was a senior at that time, was, I think, a couple home runs away from the career home run record, which is, like, outstanding. And we had such a talented team, and we felt like this could be our year. It was devastating to the players. It was devastating to the coaches. I mean, as a coaching staff, you know, our coaches work so hard for our guys, and put in so much time recruiting year round, and you recruit for that year. You know, like, we spent a year and a half being like, okay, that 2020 team, we're gonna have, you know, Ryan Zweer and Joe Otto and Max and Ben Ruvo as sophomores and a really talented junior class. Like, that's gonna be our year, and this is what we need. And then like that, it's gone, and it's like all the work to put that team together, you never get to see the fruits of that. You know, we'll never know how good that 2020 team could have been. Like, that feeling, that's never gonna go away. And we're always kind of chasing, trying to make up for that, you know, especially while guys that are on the team that were here are still here. But it's kind of like just a pit in your stomach that you'll never get rid of. One of the strongest things of our program is our team culture. And that's not because of me or because of our coaches, it's because of our players, and I think a big part to our senior class.
C
CJ Gillmer. CJ's been a four-year captain on this team since I've been here as a freshman. He's been a great leader, always brings energy. He's always the guy that brings us together when things are going wrong, but also when things are going well. I think he's been the definition of a true leader these past 4 years.
When I stepped on campus, I immediately felt like he was someone that guys on the team looked up to.
There's nobody out there that we'd want in a bigger moment than him, and as a coach, I fully trust him.
My name's CJ Gillmer. I'm from Doylestown, Pennsylvania, and I play shortstop. So the Ruvo twins, Ben and Max, are, if you want to look at their numbers, it's like those guys are studs, and they've helped our team day in and day out for years. The things they do in the outfield, the speed that they offer in our outfield and on the bases, and the way they swing the bat is next to nobody in this conference. I don't believe in this country.
They both bring such unique, similar, but completely different skill sets to the table, both as players and as people. Those guys eat, breathe, and sleep the game of baseball.
I'm Max Ruvo. I'm a senior here at Washington College. I'm Ben Ruvo. I'm a senior. I'm from North Colwell, New Jersey, and I play the outfield, and I'm an outfielder. Tied for the best looking guy on the team, my identical twin, Max. You know, he's a tremendous competitor. He's one of the more competitive people that I know, and that's something that has taken him a long way. He's, you know, a pure gifted hitter, regardless. Like, he just knows how to hit. I've looked up to him in terms of his offensive capabilities, and it's been fun to watch.
Talk about size, speed, and athleticism. You know, a lot of people can hit home runs. A lot of people can steal a lot of bases. When you have somebody that can hit home runs and steal bases, you know you have a special talent, and that's what Max is at his best. We had a lot of guys, you know, that could have been captains. We felt Ben perfectly personified what we're looking for in a captain with his work ethic, his communication skills. Ben is unselfish. He expects a lot out of himself, but he's extremely unselfish.
I think Ben, you know, on top of him being my identical twin brother with a triplet sister, he's been, you know, my best friend, and for the past, you know, 22 years of your life, I feel like we've been pretty inseparable. His outfield defense is still the best I've seen. And I've always looked up to him as a player and as a person. And I would say him being a captain this year, there's no one that deserves it more than him. And he's really put in a lot of hard work.
All we got to do is be top four. We just want a chance because, I mean, this is my fifth year here, and we've never even had a chance to take it any further than the regular season.
One thing about music, when it hits you, feel no pain. And I swear I got this shit that make these bitches go insane. So they tell me that they love me, I know better than that. It's just game, it's just what comes with the fame. I'm ready for that, I'm just saying, but I really can't complain. Everything is kosher, two thumbs up, Eva and Roper. I really can't see the end getting any closer, but I probably still be the man when everything is over. So I'm riding through the city with my high beams on. Can you see me, can you see me? Get your vibes in.
I'm nervous, I don't know what to say. Here we go. Oh, pick me. That boy Danny! Oh, that's not it, coach. I forgot how tired this was. All this mic's hearing is my chain right now. It's just hearing Jack breathing in my chain. You good, you good. How is he?
I only saw two sliders. So I didn't see any.
Did you see fastball?
Nope. Two sliders.
How are they? They're tight, right? But they're not overpowering.
No.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah, it's stay back.
Okay.
It's three sliders.
Yeah, some. You only saw two pitches?
Yep. He's,
where was I, dude?
Yeah, so probably gonna see some breakers. It's a fastball adjust.
Our team was shaping up to be special, and I felt that in the fall. We had a lot of great talent, especially among the freshman class. This is one of the best freshman classes I think I've seen here.
Cael Magill and Joe Morrissey, who, you know, are roommates and actually played together, you know, different points during their high school and travel ball career. And those are two guys that we are so fired up right here because they bring the unique mix of being really, really talented players, but being exactly the type of guys we want representing our program.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Just missed it. Gotta keep my body connected.
They're both very emotional baseball players. Now we're seeing Max battle an in-season injury, and the mental toughness that it takes to see him do what he's doing every day, and he's just visibly in some serious pain, but he wants himself to be in the lineup every day because, again, he knows that it helps us win.
Coming into senior year, being like the last year of baseball for 19 of us, I think there were even higher expectations than our sophomore year because we have such an old group. We always joke around that our average age is probably older than like the Baltimore Orioles. Well, we went to the field to practice before fall ball started, and we were long tossing, and I threw the ball and felt my oblique pull, and I didn't know at the time, but I ended up tearing my oblique right before fall ball started in September. September 2nd was the day I actually tore my oblique, you know, because it starts in the fall. That's when a lot of players break out. Everyone gels as a unit. You get a lot of game reps. I didn't play in the summer because of an internship I had, so it was a time for me to see live at-bats, just get to be with the guys again, and it was a really challenging fall because I kind of felt a little disconnected from the team. I was in a pretty dark place with the injury. I wasn't able to do team lifts. I wasn't able to play at practice. I was in the booth doing music, which, you know, DJ might be my second calling, but I would have rather been on the field with the guys playing that fall and competing with each other and having a good time, being like the last fall, because the fall is a really fun time to be a player here. But Coach Triano and I kind of figured out what it was and what we had to do to fix it. So I went from September 2nd to January 21st with limited baseball activity. But my goal was to get back that February and be ready for the season. So February 1st came around, I was finally back, I was feeling good. Obviously I felt it tick off a little bit because I didn't play for so long, but I was working really hard to get to the point where I could help the team win. The seniors were going to be there for us through every step of this journey, as far as baseball, school, life, and that's true. Throughout this season, there's been so much evidence and proof that these guys are here for us, and we're brothers. It doesn't matter our age, our size, how good we are. We're just a tight-knit group of guys who are there for each other no matter what. Florida's always a stretch where we normally play pretty well. Warm weather, just baseball, we're only focused on baseball. We felt like our team was in a unique spot with experience, youth, and high expectations that we held for ourselves. This was a point in the season where me personally, with my injury, I felt like I was kind of turning the corner. I tried to be on the field as much as possible, especially your senior year. You never want to really sit out your senior year. You know, it's your last year being on the field with some of your closest friends competing for a championship. Tweaked my quad again and had to miss the rest of Florida. Fortunately, we were a very deep team. We had a bunch of guys step in and play.
Which was one of the best weeks of the season that I know our players and coaches really look forward to.
Attaboy! Let's go! Pick up cap! Attaboy! Attaboy! Let's go! Twisted!
Who, Bates?
Cael makes up all
Bates, you got big arms.
You say a lot of bad words.
Who's got the biggest biceps on the team?
Yeah. Ethan has
Bates, you got hit biceps.
Oh, Ethan?
Ethan
biggest biceps on
Brower.
The team. Brad?
One set of
biceps. Biggest biceps. Don't nominate Brad.
Oh, he's in there. Let's go.
Go.
That went low.
Yes, sir!
Go home, big sir.
Oh, yeah! Double line, keep him moving, go!
That's good. You know what's good? You get like six chicken breasts, throw in some butter, half honey mustard and half hot sauce. Leave it in there for like on low for like 3 hours.
We're good. So you cook that?
Oh, all the time.
All the time.
All the time.
I love that.
I want to steal JJ's hat and wear it for a little bit though.
Boys are looking ready.
I really do think I'm gonna steal JJ's hat and wear it for a little bit. Just see what happens.
Yes.
We can throw a hat.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Straight out of Texas right there.
Do I look all right? Do I look all right? What's going on?
Oh, jeez.
It's a little scary.
Hey, that doesn't make me nervous or anything.
I wasn't ready last time. My spine
just collapsed. Hey, I go like full.
Should I do my toe touch?
Yeah.
I can do my toe touch. Yeah. All right, ready? Here it is. Here's my toe touch. Ready?
Hey!
Hey!
Hey! He definitely does have way bigger calves than I do. Dude, I got no calves. They look like I
just screwed up. Do you skip leg day?
No, I don't skip leg day. However, it does look like I do based off of my calves.
All right, my name is Cael Magill. I'm a freshman here at Washington College. I'm from Acco, New Jersey, and I'm an outfielder for the baseball team.
Cael's my guy. Cael, he's one of the more energetic guys on the team. Literally is the most positive person I've ever met in my life.
Baseball for me began probably before I could even remember. I started playing T-ball when I was probably about 5 or 6, and baseball stuck to me ever since. I probably didn't take the sport seriously until I was about 11. That's when my family decided it was time to place me on a travel team. So baseball is something in my family that my brothers and I kind of picked up on as we grew up, but it's not something that really ran in the family until us.
So he's always got a smile on his face. He's like my little brother on the team. He's in center field with me all the time. He's somebody who I've tried to help mentor in the outfield as that like next outfielder for Washington College.
I had a phone call with Cael at the beginning of the recruiting process, and as soon as I hung up that, I try to get to know guys a little bit and see what their interests are and see if it could align to go to that next step in the recruiting process. And I hung up that phone and a phone call, and I told my wife, I was like, that's the best initial phone call I've ever had. That was such an impressive young man. And I knew from that moment, like, we wanted that young man in our program.
Gage, you get swings, coach is going to throw. We'll just do, probably do 6-6-4. So everyone should get three rounds. Don't worry about bunting or hitting runs. We'll go 6-6-4, you can get loose. The groups out here, here's the plan. We're going to have, start with the runner at first. We're going to sack, we're going to have a hack out. We're going to sack bunt him to second. So we want the bunt up the first baseline. We're going to sack bunt him to third. Want the bunt up the third baseline. We're gonna safety squeeze, okay? Then we're gonna go runner back to first. We'll go around that way. And the second time through, runner at first, we're gonna hit and run, right? And then we'll, instead of having that guy go to third, we'll have him stay at second. Then we're gonna have a runner at second, two strikes. We're gonna work on moving him over. Then we're gonna have him at third. And less than two outs, drive him in. Does anyone have a preference on if you'd want to start bunting, go here?
I would love to start bunting.
Go here. We'll see how this works.
Bunting wins championships. Realistically, bunting wins championships. It does. Here we go. Time to show off the wheels.
Safety squeeze. More Cael.
Oh, yeah.
Overhead.
So it's first base, third base, squeeze, bump for hit. Got it. All right. There we go. Oh, that's money. Oh. Darn it. Here we go. Oh, I'm so there. Money. I got hot dogs, or no, wiener dogs dressed as hot dogs. Me and Josh have matching socks, it's great.
Do you like search online for those specific socks, or were you just like funny socks and those came up? Like, I can't imagine you Google search like wiener dog socks.
Well, normally I just get funny socks, but Josh actually requested that I get these. So I got two pairs, and now me and him have matching socks.
Oh, okay.
So they do Funny Sock Friday in the weight room. So now we share socks. It's great. We're not sharing, but have the same socks. That'd be weird if shared socks. We can't let the team score that way at the end of the game, right? If there's one out, we can take a chance on that. If there are two outs, the only way we're making that play is if it's a routine play. And that wasn't, because as catchers, we have our gear on, we're moving in a different direction. That's a very tough play. You need to throw the ball. Can you throw the ball?
Want me to throw it for you, Zan?
Blown squeeze. Throw the ball. Squeeze. Good job, good job. Yep, yep.
You said Johei Ohtani?
Johei Motani.
Why Mo?
Because Morrissey.
Johei Motani.
So Joe Morrissey is my roommate, but before that, I've known Joe since I was 13, and he's somebody that I really look up to when it comes to hard work.
Joe Morrissey is such a bulldog on the mound, loves the game of baseball, is an extremely hard worker. He was a guy that had the opportunity to play at all different levels of baseball, you know, Division I, Division II, Division III, junior college, and you know, he decided to come here because I think he saw that we were building something special, and he knew he could, you know, play a role in that right away, and that's proven to be true.
I'm Joe Morrissey. I'm from Morristown, New Jersey, and I'm a freshman. I was one of those kids that like played all the sports, like wrestling, football, lacrosse. It eventually got down to baseball and lacrosse, which were both spring sports. I could see myself not playing lacrosse, but I didn't know what I would do if I didn't have baseball. And it's funny, like my mom would actually say that I was better at lacrosse, but you know, I looked at it like baseball is a harder sport, and there's more challenges in baseball, there's more failure, and I, for some reason, even at that age, I feel like I knew like the lessons that baseball had already taught me and like what it would continue to teach me.
another guy that carries himself like he's a 23-year-old fifth year already. His presence on the mound is felt both by our dugout and the opponents, and I know I wouldn't want to face him if I wasn't wearing a Shoreman jersey, so I feel bad for the guys that have to step in the box against him because he always wants the ball back and he always just wants to blow a fastball by the next guy.
You know, so I decided I went with Washington College because Coach Beddick told me, you know, even if you weren't a pitcher, we'd want you as a hitter too. And I think it was that like confidence in me that I really wanted in the coach. It's so far it's been the best decision I've ever made. Like I tell younger guys that are looking at schools, like if I had a D1 opportunity, but I knew what this was going to be like here, I think I'd still come here, just because the culture here it's second to none. Like I've never been on a team that was so welcoming and just baseball focused and just wanting to like win.
We're doing slide plays?
Oh!
Yeah. If you
want
to, sure.
How about
the Jeter jump throw?
Yeah, if you want, yeah.
Going to the stands after?
Yeah.
What guy?
Just like you're in the field of play and then just momentum takes you. He's up. Let's go, Bendo. Sports Center.
Something nice.
Let's go.
Yeah.
Oh.
Hey, go.
Ah. Hey, one of these right there.
Hey, Nita. You gotta be perfect, so if it's on your bare hand side, go for it. That's gonna be way quicker than getting around the ball.
Work.
Work. That works.
It gets to your right to barehand if it's your left. Don't get around
that. Not that one, you have a
barehand. Hey, you're doing the middle.
Pull the ball!
So we were the first opponent on our conference schedule was Swarthmore, who in 2018 they went to the College World Series, and really talented coaching staff, really talented team. We were excited to start off with them in conference play because that, you know, I felt and we felt as coaches that it would give us a pretty good idea of where things stand. They're definitely in the upper echelon of teams in the conference. I think they were picked to finish second or third in the preseason poll. So it was a battle of two really talented teams. You know, game one on Saturday. You know, we jump out to an early lead. I think we were up 3 or 4 nothing. And then we give up a big inning. We're down a couple runs. Things aren't looking great, but really proud of the team. And we were able to bounce back and put up a bunch of runs later in the game and actually take a 2-run lead in the 8th inning. It went from feeling pretty down, and you know, before that, it looked pretty bleak to guys bouncing back and focusing in and taking a lead. And really, we had all the momentum, you know. And in the bottom of the 8th inning, we're up 2 runs, you know, at Swarthmore, a really good team. I mean, if you tell me right now that we have a 2-run lead in the 8th inning against those guys, you know, sign me up for that anytime. So we were in position to win that game. You know, unfortunately, we didn't. I mean, and if you look back at that game, we walked or hit, our pitchers walked or hit 12 guys, 12 Swarthmore hitters. Their pitchers walked or hit us twice. So we gave them 10 more free passes. And I think the final score ended up 11-8. But even with all that being said, you know, right there at the end, we have a chance. Even though we hadn't played up to our abilities, we have a chance to win it at the end. And we came up short. So game two, you know, we're looking forward to the team bouncing back. You know, we had our first year freshman pitcher, Joe Morrissey, on the mound, who's had an extremely, extremely impressive season. We felt really good about going into that game. We fell behind early. Some calls went against us. You know, I actually was ejected in the 4th inning. I deserved to get thrown out. We had a call go against us, and I reacted, and I was given a warning, and I knew if I kept arguing, I was going to get thrown out of the game. But at that point, I felt like it was in the best interest of our team to go ahead and do that because of the life it might bring back into it. In the top of the 10th, you know, we had a bang bang play at the plate. Our guy got thrown called out on what I felt like was the wrong call, and we had two of our players, including, you know, our sophomore first baseman Danny Sheeler, get ejected from the game. Well, at the you know, NCAA baseball, if a player gets thrown out of a game, they're then suspended for the next game. So in the top of the 10th inning, you know, we had two guys get thrown out. Those two guys would have actually hit in the 11th inning. So instead of having, you know, two of our better players hit in the 11th, we had a pinch hit, you know, in those spots. So two guys, we weren't able to be successful. They ended up winning in the bottom of the 11th. So I really felt like those ejections impacted that game. And because there were players that got ejected, we didn't have them for our third game of this season against Haverford. So, you know, we had a very good team meeting on Monday that lasted about an hour, where, you know, I've never had a team meeting like this where we kind of put everything on the table, what we're trying to accomplish, what wasn't acceptable from the games on Saturday, what, you know, what we expect of each other moving forward. And I felt like, you know, that was needed. You know, even though we didn't win on Tuesday, I felt much better about our program, our team, win or losing, because at the end of the day, there's some things that are more important than winning and losing, and how we treat each other, the type of teammates we are, the type of men we are, like, that stuff matters.
Hey, great start! How about Zay?
And, you know, we weren't at full strength on Tuesday. So, we lost our three-hitter, Max Ruvo, in the first inning. You know, we were down our you know, two other middle of the lineup hitters. And, we were up 6-0, I think, in Tuesday's game. And, again, that's the third conference game in a row that we've had a lead. And, again, another very deflating loss, very important game against a good team. And we weren't able to get it done. But I was really proud with, you know, improving on those other things that I mentioned earlier, being good teammates, good energy, supporting each other, you know, not complaining to umpires. Like, all that stuff was way better on Tuesday and a little bit easier to stomach. But. That's how we got to 0-3, and that's where we're at now. And we're kind of reevaluating everything, trying to figure out, okay, it's go time. We can't lose too much more ground, or, you know, we're gonna be going home in 4 weeks, and nobody wants that. So we're trying to get this thing turned around as quickly as possible, and our backs are against the wall, and we'll see what happens this weekend.
This is the last year, but I'm going to buckle up, try to just have one last, like, final impact on the team and try to push for that conference championship that we've wanted. And I had my best I think my best hitting performance since I've been here was the fall of this year. I was hitting for a lot of power, I was hitting for average. My swing was feeling really good. I was getting through the proper drills, and I was ready for that like final push of senior year. And right before the season, I was feeling some like discomfort in my hand while training, and that first weekend, I felt like a pop in my hand, and I kind of knew something was up.
I mean, I've seen Ben go through a surgery this year, and there was a time in this locker room where Ben told me that he might have gotten a call that his career might be over, and I could see that the way that hit him, and I didn't want him to know how hard that hit me. But I'm really happy now that he's fortunate to have healed faster than what could have been, and now he's putting in the work day in just so he can get back. Is he can see that we need it right now. We're battling other injuries, and the sooner he gets back, the better off we'll be. So that was a rough day for Ben, but for the rest of us as well.
That was obviously super disappointing for me, and something that, you know, I still struggle with a little bit mentally, thinking about kind of how hard like the last 2 years college baseball were for me personally.
Really good. Obviously a relief to be back. Upset with the outcome, but it was good to be out there and to see live pitching. I feel pretty good, so I'm excited to be back.
Strikes on the mound is contagious. All right, positivity today. Stay within our game. Stay back. Drive the ball the opposite way. Let's take extra 90s. Put the pressure on the defense. Make the plays. Let's get the fucking W train rolling. All right, we get one today. I swear to God, they'll keep going. All right, it all starts today. Focus every single pitch. No matter if you're down 0-2 in the count, you just made an error in the field. So what? All right, next pitch. All right, focus, energy, concentration. Let's get that W.
Let's go.
Hey, let's do it. Let's do it.
Hey, it's our turn, boys. It's our turn, right? No more. Bro, no today. Season starts today. Let's take care of business. Ready? Loud and proud.
Dogs on three. 1, 2, 3.
Come on, jump on over.
I just don't.
Come on.
Shabook!
I want Book!
Yeah!
Boy!
Moving on for the Green Terror, four scout and 14 Tyler Young.
Efficiency!
Joe Moe!
Boy, Joe!
to the basement.
Oh, we got a guy.
Got a guy. Get a corn.
Yeah, we'll cover that.
One is gone. Danny Sheeler sends that to the deepest part of the ballpark, and just like that, the Shoremen are on the board. Much of all, Mr. Sheeler, as Danny gets the party started here in Chestertown. 1-0 Shoremen.
Later, number 19.
Oh! Yeah!
Sheeler rips this to right field, and that is down for a base hit as one run is in, and they're waving Baker home. And three runs will score. Base is clearing double for Danny Sheeler.
Ruvo makes it an easy 13-3 Washington.
So we're back here at the top of the ninth. Shoremen looking to close things out on what has been a beautiful day in Chestertown. Senior Alex Benowitz out of Central Park South High School. Bringing a miss from Yon.
That's Fuego!
Hey, we got 2 more weeks left, all right? Let's keep it going today, right? We got the train going on the tracks. It left the station. There are no more stops on this train, all right? Chew.
Yeah! Hey, we got to keep this offense rolling, right? We got to score a lot of runs, so let's take care of it.
One, two, three! One, two, three!
I'm a threat. I'm a kid with your life, cause you know that it's okay.
Patrick Owen.
Ooh.
So I was in center field in I think the third or fourth inning, and there was a ball hit deep to center field, and the wind was really blowing, so I couldn't really hear my left and right fielder, you know, saying room, 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 or fence, fence, fence. I was kind of just going back on the ball, and by the time I got to the ball, it was a split decision. It was either lay out or let it go, so I decided to lay out, and I dove pretty much right into the fence, and my wrist and hand took a majority of the impact, and then my face followed, which was kind of a blessing in disguise. So even though I broke my wrist, it's a lot better than like breaking my neck or, I don't know, something worse. So right away, I felt a pain in my wrist where the bone was broken, but nothing swelled up. I was actually able to play two more innings and take an at bat after I got injured. But after that at bat, when I swung, I just felt cracking all throughout my hand and all the way up my arm, and I knew something was wrong. So I went up to coach and I was like, hey, like, I'm not able to play. Like, my hand is really hurting, even though it wasn't swollen at that point. So Matt decided to put me in ice, and by the time I took the ice off 20 minutes later, my hand was completely blown up. It looked like a balloon. So at that point, I knew something was really wrong, and I was kind of holding out, hoping it was just a sprain, but deep down I knew something was definitely wrong. So as far as my season goes, it's pretty much done at this point from a playing standpoint, but I definitely am excited to embrace my new role on the team. I think this weekend was a great experience because I was able to really be more of a dugout presence rather than on the field. And it was kind of cool, you know, giving back to my teammates who were there and helped me all throughout my season while they were injured. So now watching them have an opportunity to play and succeed, it was really cool to watch and, you know, be with them through that process.
How are you feeling about today's game?
Oh, we're gonna win.
Calling it right now?
The vibes are high.
I agree. Henry Butterfield is locked in. I mean, look at him.
Twins are back in the lineup. We're locked.
Dude, the OG outfield is back. Got Max Ruvo in left, Ben Ruvo in center, and Chris Baker in right. The old man squad, I like to call it. I think they're gonna go off.
Bellick's been hitting the ball well. He's in the lineup.
Yeah, I agree. I also think, today is CJ Gilmer's breakout day. I know he had one against McDaniel, but this is part two.
This was my first weekend back from my quad injury, so I was all taped up, ready to go, amped up that Friday against FNM. And I was actually mic'd up, and in the mic up, I kept saying, it's good to be back, I'm back. Like, let's do this, like, let's make a run to get into the playoffs.
I'm pretty excited to be back out here with the boys.
The vibes are high.
At FNM. Got a big week ahead. Can solidify ourselves in the conference. It's been killing me not being out here with the guys. So I'm pumped to be back. Vibes. My quad, it's like, it's broken, but it still works, you know? Like, there's a lot of highs and lows.
Get knocked down, get up again.
Yeah, you get knocked down, you get up again. I'm feeling good, the quad's feeling loose. I'm ready to go, no holding back. Senior year, good vibes only. Right, Layler area? Let's go, Connor. You're on the mic. Say what's up.
Yo, you popping top over there?
Hi, Mom.
Popping top in the camera?
Hey, Jay.
I'm so fired up right now.
Yeah, be fired up. Baseball on Friday, five games, next 3 days. It's like we're in Florida, but we're not.
Yeah, I mean, if you're not fired up right now, you don't like
baseball. PCH driving, I need some inspire. I'm ready to go. Ready to go.
No, no, no.
Right, if we're up to the plate, we're out of the box, just think about what we're gonna do in the plate. If we're in the field right now, we're gonna do with the ball. Alright, I need you guys locked in every single pitch this game, alright? We're gonna get tired, it's gonna be hard. I need you to make a conscious effort to stay locked in this whole game. Alright, we do that, we're coming out with a win. Let's go.
Hey, we got a lot of games left. We got five of them this weekend, right? I know it's not win or go home yet, but I want win or go home baseball for the rest of the year. Win or go home mentality, playoff mentality, win or go home, right? Leave it all out there. Let's go, boys. Let's go.
Dogs on three. One, two, three.
One more thing. Shoot, motherfucking shoot.
Yeah.
Come on, two, one, more, Chris.
I want to see Billy Jean, had to let him know. Put my demons in that cage, then I let him go. Mama told me just to chill, but I feel still. When that ill will, got me turning into Kill Bill.
Going into it, we knew it was going to be a battle. At F&M, one of the best teams in the conference, but I feel like we felt very confident that in ourselves that we could come out and be the better team if we just played our game. After that first inning, I kind of fell into a groove, and I was getting a lot of weak contact, especially with my off-speed pitches. I was locating very well. I think our offense sparked some momentum early. I think it was like the seventh, we scored four to go up 5-1. And after that, that was the first time where I kind of relaxed a little bit.
What's the over-under on wins?
I'm saying a 30.
Oh, I was going to go 20.
20?
Start with 20.
20's a
trip.
30 up there?
That's an ordeal.
When you're hitting in those last innings, though, like, you're either like...
This tunes everything out. It's very good.
But you're either like, you know you're feeling confident if you're not like nervous or anxious, but you're just like, no.
Dig
you
in.
Don't feel anything.
You don't, you tune literally everything out.
My arm felt numb.
My inside.
I'm gonna wash my hands, Joe.
My arm was pretty numb.
We won that game at F&M. Shout out Brandon Hoffman or Tony Gwynn, as I like to call him. And then we're going to Gettysburg.
Feels weird. It's like I have something on my shoulder.
Whoa! That. What kind of, what's that stretch called? What is it? That was cool. If he does it again, let me know. My swing didn't feel 100%, but it's funny. In the hotel room the night before Gettysburg, I was in the mirror doing dry swings. And Baker's in the hotel room. He's like, Moose, what are you doing in the mirror? And I'm practicing something. I'm working on an adjustment. And I made a minor adjustment. Came back to Gettysburg the next day after a great win at F&M. We're all fired up.
Come on, Max.
Get us going, Bob.
Make team defense. Don't beat yourself just because you want to hit really bad. I love that, but let them come to you. Get a pitch, drive it that way if you're like. If you're ready, drive it that way. You get the ball in, freaking piss on it. Play your game. Don't play their game, all right? He's going to come after you guys. Wait. Wait to strike when it's the perfect time. All right? Let's go. Let's go.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Let's
go.
Dropped the first one against Gettysburg, but I'm starting to finally feel my swing again. I was 1-for-5 the first game with a triple after I got hit by a pitch. I'm sure a lot of guys on the team can remember. I play with a lot of raw emotion. It might not be beneficial, but when I hit that triple off that kid, I slid into third, stared at the third baseman, screamed on back, looked at the pitcher and said, I bet you wish it hit me now. And for some reason, that's kind of when the I'm back started. Game two at Gettysburg, we won a great game, up big. Had one inning where they got back into it, but earlier in that game, I hit my first home run of the year, and you know, the weight off my shoulders is an understatement. Because I just worked so hard to get back and contribute to this team and help the team win in any way I could. And naturally, as I hit that home run, I'm circling around third base, pointing to the team, I'm back. And that's kind of when this started. That's twos, for those who doesn't know, I'm number 22.
Hell yeah, Max!
Yeah, there's a saying about when teams make the playoffs. They don't ask how. Right? So it means they don't ask you how you won game number 3, game number 7, game number 10, whatever. It doesn't matter what just happened in that game, you got it done. Right? We got two more tomorrow. We got to come out and focus, right? Forget what just happened, come out, you're ready to play. Take two.
Like, that was fluky, man. Yeah, man, keep your head up. Like, that was fluky. Like, they brought guys off the bench who didn't know what they were doing. They just threw their barrels at balls and found gaps, and then all the momentum started. So keep your heads up, because you guys, that game too, I was happy with how we played. It gets tougher tomorrow, okay? Because, you know, we're a little bit more tired. We played 27 innings. There's a whole lot of reasons why we can make excuses to not come out and play well tomorrow. But that team played the same number of games we did, right? And we're going to want it more. We're going to have to dig deeper into our depth. We're going to need some guys to step up and maybe haven't been asked to do it. All right, and you guys are going to be ready to go, and you're going to get the job done, okay? Because we're a team, and we're all in this together, right? And no one cares tomorrow what happened in this game. Nobody cares. So we got to move on, move past, and get ready to go tomorrow. It's a whole new day, okay? And if we can lock in and have a really good day tomorrow, all right, we're right where we want to be, okay? So split, okay? Okay, a little disappointing. We won game two. Tomorrow, we got to be ready to roll. Because we got a team coming to our place Sunday afternoon. It's going to be 80 degrees.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Right? We're going to score a ton of runs. Some pitchers are going to fill it up. We're going to play great defense. And we're going to sweep it.
Yeah. Let's
go. Hey, tomorrow's going to come down to who wants it more, right? It's got to be us.
I want it.
Max.
Hey, yes. We've been swept tight twice. We've swept twice. And now we split tight twice. Time to get it back on track. We're going bear hunting tomorrow. Bring the energy.
Go ahead.
Guys, I want to make a point, too. Like, we got to realize, we're fucking deep in our fucking lineup. Like, we got guys coming off the bench, on and off. We're blowing leads, but whatever. Like, we're deep as shit. Like, we can get through it. Like, we got a big squad here.
Let's go.
Yeah.
Let's go.
Yeah.
Let's go.
Here we go. I'm fucking hungry.
One, two, three.
It's our house today, right? It's our house.
Texas house.
Let's go bear hunting.
Pumpkin! Pumpkin! Drumming on three! 1, 2, 3!
Sure. Kind of repeating these like thoughts in my head, like, you know, stay on the gas, like, you know, stay on their neck. Like, you know, the moment you let up and go out there and, you know, you don't put the extra oomph in a pitch that you need to get it where it needs to be, that's the difference between, you know, a hit and a strikeout. So I think that's just been the challenge, and what I've learned this year, especially in college with 9 innings instead of 7, is like it's a marathon, not a sprint, which is something that Coach Beck talks about a lot. And I think that kind of goes with everything in baseball.
Split against Gettysburg, have our sinus at home. Game one, we win a great game. Feeling really good. I hit a hit probably my only no doubter in my career.
Oh, boy, lifted, bat flip, gone, Ruvo. Touch them all, as he knew right away, folks.
Max Ruvo sends that into orbit. Ooh, it's 5-1.
I haven't
Washington.
Seen that. I haven't seen that this year yet.
He knew it.
Yeah.
Touch them all, Mr. Ruvo.
Oh, yeah. Feeling himself after that one. We'll have to get back to you on the exit velocity numbers there, but
yeah.
Woo!
What a snap cast up on that one. That one is destroyed. Oh, out of here in a heartbeat.
Huge hits. Max Ruvo, bomb.
Little man.
Bomb.
Little man.
Noah had a couple hits. Lay seal. Hoff came up huge with that two out single. Just good job all the way around. Roseman. He gave us three. And Joe Morrissey, hell of a job. He gave us everything he got. Had to come in yesterday and then to throw six today. That's exactly what we needed.
We lose game two at our sinus, but 3-2, not bad. We go to the next week knowing that we essentially have to sweep Johns Hopkins for the first time in school history.
Our defense was really good today for the most part. Pitching was really good. Bench was into the game. Guys were playing hard. I'm really proud of the way you guys battled. We just came up short in game two, okay? We need to regroup. We got a big week. Let's make sure it's not our last week, all right? Because we put ourselves in position to keep playing after this week. But it's a big week coming up. All right, we're gonna enjoy it. We're gonna have fun competing. But it's go time. We got Hopkins coming here on Tuesday. All right, they're a good team. They aren't as good as they normally are. Okay, and that doesn't mean we just show up and play. What I'm saying is this allure of like, oh, it's Johns Hopkins. That ain't there. Okay, they got swept by Muhlenberg yesterday at Muhlenberg. They are a very beatable team. They're not feeling very confident right now, I can tell you that. They're licking their wounds in a Tuesday. And we're looking up at them in the standings. Right? We take care of business Tuesday and give ourselves a shot to take care of business Friday. I'll tell you what, every single person that knows anything about college baseball is a Washington College Shoreman fan this week, right? Including every other Centennial Conference team.
Tuesday's our game to win. Okay, so let's get ready. It's a playoff game. It's a winner go home baseball game. All right, let's get ready to go. In tight, heads up. Going on three. 1, 2, 3. Go!
Going into that Tuesday was kind of like I was excited, but I knew that there was a chance, like in previous years, that I don't know, they're Johns Hopkins, and they definitely show up everywhere thinking that they're going to win. Johns Hopkins is a team I can say that I've never beaten, and nobody that I've played with here in my 5 years has ever beaten them either. So Coach Beddick told us before the game that they're not the same team they usually are, and I think a lot of guys bought into that.
This allure of like, oh, it's Johns Hopkins, that ain't there.
And we really believed that we had a chance.
They're not very talented, and I'm not afraid to say that.
So you guys keep doing what you're doing, and we'll get you back on Tuesday, all right? Tuesday is the biggest game of my college career, and I've been here for 5 years. You guys understand that? Tuesday's our game to win.
About it. All right, ready? Heavenly Father, thank you for the incredible opportunity to be out here on this beautiful field with our brothers. Just lead us today in everything that we do and help us come out with the W.
I'm sick and fucking tired of these guys rolling in here and taking one from us every year. I've never beat them. Right? Nobody here has beat them. Has anyone beat them?
No.
No.
Me neither.
And this year we have a really good shot, right? And we got to set the tone for the rest of the season today. The rest of the year starts today. The playoffs for us start today. Bring the energy, light the fire, and let's take care of business.
Wait, CJ.
Yeah, go ahead. You hungry again?
What's that? Behind your ear.
Is there something?
Dogs on three. 1, 2, 3.
Going into that game, we knew it was like one of the, probably the biggest game to that point that we've ever had. I mean, at home against Hopkins, we're both fighting for a spot in the conference tournament. We have to basically win out if we lose that one. So going into it, I knew it was a big game, but I mean, I don't really get nervous. You know, the first couple innings was kind of a struggle. I mean, I was walking guys, I was hitting guys. Guys were getting bloop hits, stuff like that. There was runners on, I think, the first and second inning, like in scoring position with less than two outs. I was able to get some key strikeouts, like at key times, big times. And then I think in between innings, I kind of started to notice some things that they were doing. I think they were like very, very aggressive. And I noticed the umpire was kind of giving me more calls like off the plate. So I talked with Bukowski and was like, hey, they're being aggressive. Like, let's expand the zone, especially when I'm ahead in the count. Like, don't be afraid to go more off the plate because I think they'll still be swinging at it. Around the fifth inning, where we started to get some runs.
I don't know, I have this late power surge in my career, maybe in the fifth year. No, probably not. But, you know, hit another one, circled the bases, claimed to be back. At this point, it's probably getting old, but I'm just so excited to be back and helping the team flash the twos.
Offense has kind of always been going. Our pitching turned it around after the first week of conference play, but our defense hadn't quite been there yet, and we needed it to be there that day, and it was.
Once we started to score some runs, I noticed like a flip in their lineup where they kind of started to panic, which was like at that point I knew the game was over. Like I think the fifth inning, it was a big game for them too, and I think that's when I was like, all right, I'm gonna like finish this game around the sixth inning, and like just ended up being coming true. Like I don't know how to describe it. It's just kind of like, I knew the game was over in the sixth. I just had to keep going, and I just did that.
In a winner-go-home game, he threw 9 innings, shut out, giving up only 4 hits against a team that we've never beaten in our entire career. And I think that's the proudest I've ever been of him. I would consider him my best friend.
Ryan Mostoller, Mingo, amazing performance. Carried the team on his back that day, complete game.
We took a game off Johns Hopkins on Tuesday behind Ryan Mostoller. And we were now tied with them and a bunch of other teams still in the hunt.
Once you're top four, you're in the playoffs, and anything can happen at that point. And we knew that. We know that we have the talent to make a run at the Centennial Conference, and we just had to get in. We just had to get into the dance. I remember that night, probably the only night of the year I had trouble sleeping, because I knew how much this playoff berth would mean to our team and the school.
We were tied with them in the standings, and going into the day, we didn't know if we had to win one or if we had to win two, but obviously we had to choose to take the mindset that we had to win two.
We have big bad Joe Morrissey on the mound.
Every game is important, but I love playing in big games. Like, I love the pressure and, you know, the challenge of that.
Let's jump on it today. Let's jump on it. Let's leave no doubt, right? We saw yesterday there's a lot of fight in this dog. The dog's got to keep fighting today, right? Today's our day. We're at our place. There's going to be a lot of people here. There's going to be a lot of energy. These guys are tired. These guys don't want to be here. Let's put them in the dirt. Let's put them away. Max, go ahead.
Guys, I don't know about you guys. But I woke up a little hungry. I want everybody to
think that. Oh, hungry.
Oh, everybody.
Oh, everybody. Oh, yeah.
Dogs on 3, 1, 2, 3.
Sure, man.
you find me. When the sun rises, when the sun.
With today's victory, your showman will officially clinch a spot in next week's Centennial. Now a score here, AP Park, short and six. Dickinson back up with 0.
Hit to me. I remember tagging second and being pretty excited, but not knowing if we had to win the next game or not. And the announcers came over the PA system and announced that we clinched the playoffs. And I just remember hugging my teammates and getting very emotional, and just hearing the alumni in left field going crazy and hugging all my my fifth year buddies, because we came back for this chance, and we didn't get it before. So the fact that all of our hard work and everything, all the time and effort we've put into this is paying off, and now we have a shot, is all that we could have asked for. So
accomplishing something that this program hasn't accomplished in 10 years, being able to do that while active and not from like with a cast on or anything either, where I thought my career was so glim, I never thought I'd be on a field again. And running off of that field is something that I'll remember forever. It's something that I'll show that like if you put your mind to something, and that if you work hard and stay the course, like you can make a comeback and make an impact and be on that field. And running off the field and seeing all the alumni, that was something that was super special. Those are some of our best friends, and they're our brothers. You know, those are some guys who from COVID weren't able to get a chance of what we were able to do this year. And to them, I think it was just as special to them as it was to us. Seeing the alumni after we clinched was the best feeling in the world. You know, a lot of those guys were from that sophomore year team that we didn't accomplish our goals due to COVID, but what could have been. And, you know, we were playing, you know, for this team, but I felt like in a lot of ways we were also playing for that team, kind of showing like what we were, what we could accomplish. And as although they're not here to play with us right now, they're every part of this team. As they were in 2020. And a large group of those guys I didn't even play with. The fifth years on our team played with them, and I almost feel like I've played with them with how well I know them and how comfortable we are talking to them. And just like the sheer enjoyment everyone had from that win kind of just shows how important this season was for the school, the program, but also the alumni. And it was really a special moment as we all got to kind of embrace and celebrate, and just like the raw emotion that came out from that win. Will be like my happiest moment here on campus.
And just to see them so happy for us that we did it made me very emotional again, because I remember all the years with those guys being one or two games out of the playoffs and not quite making it, and then just watching them have to finish their careers without ever having a chance. So we kept telling them that this year's for them and it's for us, but it's also for them, and we want to win for them. So that whole experience was very surreal. And just to see the excitement on those guys' faces for us, just I think is what's going to push us into this weekend, trying to bring home a conference championship.
Hey, I was doing a little research. It's been 3,651 days today since the Stormen last played a conference playoff game. And we've also never won this conference, ever in history. We can do that. This group can do that. And it starts today. We got absolutely nothing to lose. We have nothing to lose. We've made it, right? Like he said, we're good. I want to be great. Starts today. Every time you're in the box, every time your name is called, know what your job is and get it done. Let's take care of game one today, boys. Let's take care of game one.
Hey.
Oh.
I don't know about you guys, but I'm looking around. There's not a lot of places to eat out here. It's not like the fucking field. Hey, dogs on three. 1, 2, 3.
There he is,
Seb.
You are.
Hey, find me again. Give me a job. What do you say?
Max!
We're ready to go. You know, hard-fought battle at FNM. 1-0 in the fifth. Mingo's throwing a great game. I remember in the third inning or so, I get hit in the wrist.
Come on, Max!
Yeah, so Max got hit, and you know, internally in my head, I'm like, oh crap, here we go. So first things first, I mean, we always got to go up there and make sure nothing's broken, nothing's fractured, he can move, which he was able to show me that he could do. So at that point, it's just next steps of like, hey, how can we safely make sure he's playing, you know, make sure he's able to do baseball-specific things without hurting himself and making sure he doesn't get hurt any further.
I ran the bases, then got checked out on the side. I could throw the ball okay, and I had good movement in my fingers, but when I picked up a bat, I swung once in my hand. I got a shooting pain on my hand, and I thought I was done. I really didn't think I was going to be able to enter the game. And luckily, we had Matt there and Thad, who are our great great athletic trainers, and then obviously Thad's our AD here, who used to be an athletic trainer. And they're just brainstorming things for me to how to tape it to feel better. The first thing of tape is just my wrist, took a swing, didn't feel good, then they taped my hand through my wrist. When Max got hurt, obviously he's my brother, so whenever a sibling gets hurt, I have like, you know, defensive instincts. So I was not too happy when his hand was hurt and he was struggling. You know, those guys wanted to check for a foul ball. I was pretty annoyed that they were asking for a foul ball there, to be honest with you. I'm not gonna get into that stuff. But in general, when he got hurt, I originally thought, okay, well, I guess I'm going in. And you know, my hand hasn't been 100% all year. I've kind of been coming in spotty situations and where the team needs. But I was just getting loose to come in. I was ready to go in. Once he got hurt, I kind of started stretching, started getting loose. He started hitting in the cage and was able to go back in, which is kind of crazy. He really couldn't swing a bat before, 20 minutes before he went in for his next at bat.
At that point, we did what we could, tried different tape jobs that we learned, and kind of let him go at it. It was kind of stressful because in between all those innings, you know, we can't just pull him, can't not pull him. We got Coach Beddick coming up, trying to figure out, hey, is he ready to go? Is he not ready to go? Trying to make moves, and luckily, we got out of that inning. He came over, we went in the cage, did some soft toss, and he was able to go. We didn't think that he was gonna injure himself any further, so we were able to put him back in. You know, personally in my mind, I'm like, ah, okay, here we go, here's the moment of truth, because you can try everything when you're not actually in the game, but you can't ever mimic that situation in the game. So at that point, he's up there. In my head, I'm like, I hope you can swing, buddy. I mean, here we go. This is it. Like, we taped it up.
So he got checked out. Whatever Matt and Thad did, I guess they worked some magic. And he could hit again because, you know, two pitches later, he hits a home run.
Next thing, it was the second pitch. Laser beam. I'm like, I think my jaw literally hit the ground. I'm looking at the backside because Thad's standing back there, and I'm just like, here we go. So, but it's awesome just seeing these guys succeed on the field, and also just being a part of that to help them, because it's not always about like holding you out or, you know, not letting you play. It's about how do we help you to become better, but not hurt you and try to make any injury worse.
It's pretty crazy. Must be really nice to be able to do that after hurting your hand. That's ridiculous. He's a gifted hitter. You know, he just goes up there and hits. Like, it's actually unreal what he does. You know, I know how hard it is to hit with a hurt hand. So for him to just go up there after 20 minutes before, like bruising a bone kind of on his hand, was one of the more impressive things I've seen this year. Yeah, this was probably the most raw emotion I've had in a game because I really thought at that moment I wasn't going to be able to play that game and maybe that weekend. First pitch ball, second pitch, line drive down the left field line. I really felt like I only swung with one hand and snuck over the fence for a home run and I let out a lot of raw emotion, flashing the twos again, a little late career power surge that gave us some momentum there. And then, you know, fast forward to that game, we had a few more big spots in the seventh inning where we put up four runs, went up 5-1. Mingo comes back out. They get some base runners, hit the ball pretty well. Credit to them for their hitting towards the end of the game. But you know, ultimately we came out a little bit short that day with a 7-5 loss. Pretty a tough pill to swallow for a lot of us. But you know, this team's defined on resiliency all year. We play better with their backs against the wall, and you know, we played our hearts out against F&M that Thursday and played with a lot of emotion. Sometimes you just come out on the short end of the stick, but you know, coming into this weekend, we're confident. You know, we know no team's ever come out of the loser's bracket to win it all, but you know, why not us this year? One game at a time, but with their backs against the wall, if I was a betting man, I would never count out this Washington College Shoreman team, especially with a lot of our careers on the line. It should be a fun weekend. Hopefully we come out on top, and regardless, I'm extremely proud of how this team's worked this year and the resiliency we've showed, and I truly love everyone on this team, and hopefully, you know, we'll get the job done, as I know we will.
That we've then completed 5 games. But I'm saying that's not the case because you have to play 9 because it's a halting game. So in that scenario, that... Exactly. Which is stupid. Yeah, okay. Alright. Well, I'll see you tomorrow.
Yeah, so obviously, weather permitting, we were supposed to play Saturday morning at 9, but that didn't work out as planned, and that puts a damper on a lot of things. We got to pivot and kind of just adjust the best way we can. We've talked about playing on Sunday, and if we don't play on Sunday, I've heard that if everything gets canceled this weekend, that the number one seed gets the conference, which I don't anticipate happening, and that would be a pretty tough way to go out. But you know, we got to control what we can control, and what we can control right now is our effort at practice and getting ready to play whenever that is. You know, I think the last team to win it after losing their first game was Hopkins in 2015. So it's definitely something doable. Obviously, we didn't set up a great path for ourselves moving forward, and it'll be a steep hill to climb. But we've been on winning streaks before. We were hot this week. We were feeling really good. So I honestly don't think any task is too tough for this squad. We're a pretty resilient group, and I'm excited to see what we can do. The Cavs came back against the Warriors when they were down 3-1 in the NBA Finals. So if they can do that, we can run the table here and win a championship.
So yeah, I mean, after knowing what we know about, you know, the uncertainty of this weekend and potentially, you know, not even being able to like have a chance to win it anymore. You know, my initial thought was this is just kind of another of the same thing that's happened all year, where it's like, you know, backs against the wall, like I've never felt like we've been in control this season. We've never been in the driver's seat of the conference. You know, we dropped the first 4 and then, you know, scratched and clawed our way back and made the playoffs. And, you know, we dropped the first game and, you know, like from a coaching perspective, you know, that it definitely screwed up the pitching rotation situation. I think we were set up like beautifully if we had won F&M, and then, you know, I would go the second game and then, you know, Smitty closes it out in the championship. You know, and now we have to get really creative with, you know, we're gonna ask guys to step up again, which is what we've done all year, is ask guys to step up, and it's worked. You know, we're still playing. But I think, you know, my goal, and I hope everybody else's goal, and I know it is just, you know, we have to stay ready. we have this, you know, if that, we get a call that, you know, it's off and, you know, Swarthmore, you know, wins the conference, then, you know, that's not in our control. We can't, you know, we can't control that, but we're not going to check out before that happens. We're going to be ready.
Yeah, they have lights.
Play till 11 p.m.
I will jump out of the bus and drive home.
No, it'd be better.
You'd rather not play? You would rather. There's no way you'd rather.
If we had lights, we could play there.
How far away is Hopkins?
2 hours.
2 hours.
That's not
What, do you not know geography?
Do you not know
where do you think we are? Dude? Dickinson?
Dude.
Oh my god.
You're either with us or you're not.
Yeah.
You're not with us.
You're with us
right
or against us. You're with us or against us.
Yeah,
FNM kid's getting up the elevator.
Update, we were up at 6:30 in the morning.
5:45.
5 o'clock.
We're supposed to roll out. We're supposed to roll out at 7:15. Game was supposed to start at 9. It's 8:57, so we're supposed to start in the next 3 minutes. That's not going to happen. We're waiting on word from coach to see if we're going to get our games in. Poor FNM. This year having breakfast. They're supposed to play in a couple hours. It feels like COVID all over again. Yeah, you guys need to sign the consent forms. Bozeman.
So the morning we found out our season was over, we were staying at the hotel, like 10 minutes away from SWAT, and I woke up that morning ready to play. I think my alarm was set at about 5:45. I went downstairs to eat with Colbert, Baker, and Ben. We ate, had the continental breakfast. We all thought we were playing, getting ready. We looked outside. I remember Ben opened the door and was like, holy moly. It's freezing and it's windy and it's still raining from 2 days before. And I remember even going to the hotel thinking like, how are we gonna get this game in? Because it was raining so much. And then I went back out to my hotel room, got changed. It was about 7:15 and Coach Beddick told us to hang out for a minute. We were supposed to take BP at 7:45 because they were going to the field to evaluate. And a lot of us at the time, I was pretty optimistic that we were going to play. I never thought the conference would turn to not playing that day, just because how hard everyone worked, you'd think they'd be a little bit more sympathetic towards our situations. And they told us to hang out. I thought maybe they were looking into different fields to get ready for us to finish that day. Maybe go to Hopkins, where they have turf and lights. Still don't understand why we didn't move there. But he told us to hang out, and at this point we all knew it wasn't great news, but I never thought the season would actually be canceled or our playoff hopes. But as time started ticking, we didn't get an answer. And then Henry sent everybody a text, like, meet down. Into the lobby. And at that point, all the teams were there, us, Hopkins, and FNM. And we knew it wasn't good news. There were murmurs that the season was going to be canceled, which ultimately ended up happening. Coach Beddick came and kind of broke the news to us.
The commissioner is going to talk to you guys and explain.
I was pretty shocked and kind of had an outburst and asked like, why we couldn't play in a turf field. It didn't really make much sense to me. You know, I don't know if the conference just doesn't have a weather forecast, but it was pretty apparent that we were going to experience some serious rain.
She's stupid. That's actually absurd.
Yeah.
We could have played at Hopkins. Why didn't we do that?
So the thing I'll ask is, like, everything you're feeling is stuff that's been shared and that I've expressed to her, so, and to everybody. So there's nothing that you can say that's going to change anything, and there's nothing you can say that's going to make it better. The situation we're in, so we, you know, it's kind of like everything you guys have dealt with the last 2 years, that, you know, it's not fair, and you guys deserve better, but it's a situation we're in, it's part of life, right? You're going to be dealt news in life, that's not fair, and, you know, you gotta move forward, okay? But I love you guys, I appreciate you guys, and yeah, it'll be all right, I promise.
SWAT was responsible for tarping the field. Apparently it blew off at a certain point. I don't know if they didn't tarp it correctly or what, but it seems like pretty unjust, the fact that it's their field and they get to advance. It kind of like hit me like a truck. It was like, how is this possible? It didn't even really feel real. And that was kind of a hard part of it, was like realizing you're not gonna be able to walk off the field or run off the field one last time. And regardless of if we were gonna win or lose the tournament, you at least wanted a shot and know whoever won because they beat the other teams, not because of something out of your control.
And thank you guys, like, just for helping us get here, you know, and I feel bad that it's ending this way for you guys and not being able to walk off the field, like, knowing it's over, but we're here because of you guys. And we're going to be back here next year because of you guys. So make sure you guys should always be proud of setting the bar higher for us.
When I saw the tears pool up when I panned the camera and I saw it in the eyes of my brothers, that's a moment that I wish that I could erase from my mind. When I started this documentary, I gave it the title Comeback. It didn't take me long. It didn't take me long to come up with it because I knew that regardless of if we won the conference championship or if we just came close or if we didn't even make it, I knew that having a full season after these 2 years, I knew that it would be a comeback. I can't sleep at night because I'm thinking about how this isn't how it was supposed to end. It was supposed to end with a dog pile. And maybe it would have been our team, maybe it would have been another team. That was the beauty of this year, is that it could have been any team. But at the end of the day, there would be no what ifs.
There's 19 guys on our team and probably around 20 guys on the other two teams who got kind of cut out of the picture, being because of rain is just, I guess, like mind blowing. Being on the team in 2020 and 2021 and watching guys' careers end on that note makes you never think that the same kind of thing would happen to you. So being in Florida in 2020 when the pandemic first hit and not knowing if the conference or the country was gonna reopen and we were gonna be able to finish that season, and then inevitably having it not finish, and watching those guys play their last game without knowing. And in 2021, watching guys in my grade, the real seniors last year, watching them do something we've never done, placing in the top four, being a third place team and not having a playoff, unlike most conferences in the whole country. Our conference decided to just send the one seed and not give those guys the experience of a conference tournament. Watching that happen again is something that you wouldn't wish on your worst enemy, and you wouldn't wish especially on yourself. And then feeling like we're kind of out of the tunnel with the pandemic this year and getting a full season in and making the playoffs for the first time in a decade, and then having the conference take that opportunity away from us at the end after 41 games because of rain is just I guess to the guys graduating, it kind of comes across as a lack of care for the athletes in the conference, and myself and a bunch of my my teammates are feeling for the other teams too, because I mean they earned the right to have a shot just like we did. So it's not just 41 guys who got this taken away. It's over 120. It's over 40 seniors. It's kind of a wild decision to, like I said, end over 40 guys' baseball careers and over 120 guys' years of work because the field was a little wet, so. Especially this year and seeing that like this was gonna be the last year for such a big group of guys who've been together for so long, I think we always envisioned it, or I know I did always envisioned it ending on the field between the lines, probably with a loss, but knowing that like this group would have a shot and be able to like if they're gonna make us stop playing, it's because we didn't take care of business and do the things that we wanted to and envisioned to. And I think the hardest part about this decision was having our career end in a hotel lobby and being told that even though there's another week before regional selections and there's plenty of fields around us and there's still three teams that feel like they deserve a chance to keep playing and to bring a championship back to their school, I think is the hardest part, because like I would have loved to have that day that we've all seen happen where we know it's the end, but like it got to end on the field, it got to end our way, and at least we had a say in how it ended. And I think the hardest part is that it didn't get to end that way, even though that's how we envisioned it. One of my favorite things about this group of guys and this team has definitely been like the camaraderie that we all share together, whether that's on a bus, a hotel, or a weekend out, whatever it is. I love all the nicknames that we all give each other. I won't go through them because I don't want to share every backstory, but that's definitely been one of my favorite things. And it just it sucks that this group, who has contributed so much to this program, you know, they all played their last game without really even knowing it. And that's kind of been like the worst part. But you know, I wouldn't trade these guys for different teammates in the world. You know, they're my brothers for life, and very grateful for everything that this team has given me.
You know, I think the last, 24 hours have been, filled with a lot of anger and sadness. But when I look back at my time here, it's a lot of smiles and a lot of good times that I won't forget anytime soon. You know, 5 years ago now, it seems crazy that it's been that long, but it flew by in seconds. I feel like I was just yesterday in Minta with Brower, CJ, and Mingo, and now we're here 23 years old and getting ready to go. And, obviously I wish it could have ended differently, but I'll never trade any of these opportunities for anything in the world.
The last 4 and 5 years for a lot of us, I remember when we were all freshmen and meeting these guys and them kind of taking us under their wing, I guess. Our grade being so close, we came in with 24 guys and ended with 12. We, had a lot of tough experiences together going through the COVID year. Then last season only playing on the weekends, and then this year finally having a full season till the end where they canceled it on us. I would say we had a lot of good memories together and formed a very deep bond, I would say, where I know a lot of guys said they wouldn't trade it for anything, and I'm in that boat where these last 4 years have been very memorable and exciting, full of a lot of different emotion that we went through together, but Shoreman for life.
Where's Cael Magill?
One last time for this group. Maybe the last time in this house, but one last time with all of us in the same place before graduating. Sherman on three. 1, 2, 3, Sherman!
I think my naive little younger Little League self, who was so convinced that everything would come easy and that I would end up playing in the MLB. I think if I could tell that CJ, I guess sort of a sneak peek or a hint at everything that he would go through in his career, I would tell him that I'm proud. And I wouldn't trade my experiences for anything, and I'm so glad that I made the decision to come here and be a shoreman, and I got to meet some of the best people and make some of my lifelong friends. I guess this is kind of my final goodbye to a bunch of the guys on the team, but I know I'll be back, and I'm so thankful to have had the opportunity to lead you guys this year and the past year. So I guess with that being said, your captain's out.
What do you think that you know, playing baseball over the years has taught you about each other?
You know, we definitely make each other a lot better. I wouldn't be the player I am today without Ben. I actually almost stopped playing baseball my junior year of high school. I thought I was just kind of done. And then we kept playing. And, you know, pushing me to be the best player I can. But on a side note, if we were one person and combined our skills, we'd be the greatest baseball player you've ever seen. So that's true. So in a sense, we almost held each other back by being twins.
Yeah, I think that's an interesting take from what she was trying to say. We're constantly competing with each other, but it's like a healthy competition where we want each other both to succeed in the same way.
I would say our team's been a true family feel for the past 4 years. You can see that with a lot of the alumni coming back. Krams, Otto, Boog, Luke, Zaweer, Barks, even guys I never played with that keep coming around and supporting us. You just feel that every day. And I think this group will be no different, you know, knowing that the next few years will be, you know, the rest of our lives will be supporting the Shoremen, always hoping for them to go far and their continued success as this program really has meant a lot to us, and it's a true family feel. So for the last time, two's out. I've had this number since I was a kid. I was either number 11 or 33. I chose 11 here. I always thought it was a good number because I loved Brett Gardner growing up. So that was always my number, and it's gonna be weird not wearing that anymore. That's kind of just been like what I've been associated with for a long time. The number means a lot to me. In terms of Washington College and what it's given me, it's given me a great experience, a lot of highs and lows with COVID, injuries, all that stuff. But there's always been the one constant of baseball and being able to hit and stay with the program and train and work towards something. That ending is a little disappointing, but I am looking forward to the next part of my life and being an alumni here where I'll give back to the program in any way that I can. And come back and visit, see the guys, because there's still going to be guys on the team that, you know, I played with and battled with every day. So I'll definitely be back. So without further ado, I guess this is my signing off at the Washington College baseball program. And I think Max did one of these. I'm gonna do one of these sticks out. So I enjoyed my time, but yeah.
Alright, so this is my house, along with CJ and Kingman, and this is usually...
And Goose.
Are you fucking serious?
And Goose.
I live right there!
I'm sorry, you're just like right under me.
Take two.
I like that.
No, leave Goose out of it.
I'm leaving Goose out of it.
What am I, a squatter?
That's a
rat. That's a